Today we will see application of LMS to noise cancellation. Okay, last class we saw what is mu LMS algorithm and approximate gradient descent algorithm. So today we'll see some applications of least mean squared algorithm. Okay, so what is least mean squared algorithm? To introduce, we studied simple linear neuron. And we, what is neuron? Neuron has a number of inputs multiplied with a weight, and then a threshold function is applied. So that when you multiply with a weight and add, it is called linear combiner, linearly adding different quantities, or you can say linear average. Correct? No. So you have a n numbers. So n numbers you multiply with weight, each of different weights you multiply with different number and add n numbers, from n numbers you combine and get one value. So that is called linear combiner model. Our neural network or a single neuron is also called linear combiner model. Okay, in linear combiner model you will have fixed weights. Okay, now when you adapt the weights and when you iteratively derive new weights, it is called adaptive linear combiner. Weight updating neuron is also called adaptive linear combiner. Okay, so the LMS is used in your adaptive linear combiner to update the weights. This thing we saw already. Okay, now we study in today's class two applications of adaptive LMS or least mean squared algorithm. We'll see its two applications. One of them is adaptive noise cancellation. Okay, we saw a little bit about what is adaptive noise cancellation. Example, in the aircraft when you travel, inside the cabin there will be a lot of noise because of the engines of the aircraft. Okay, because of the engines you will get lot of noise inside the cabin, but it is very annoying to the travelers. Therefore the exact noise what is generated is calculated using transducers, and equal amount of anti noise is generated in an artificial manner, and that will be added inside the cabin of the aircraft, so that the noise along with anti noise they add together and to give a zero. There won't be any noise. Okay, already there is a noise, you create an anti noise and add that anti noise with the noise, so that noise will be cancelled. So you will not be annoyed with the noise in the cabin. Okay, this is one application, adaptive noise cancellation. And another application is a biomedical application where fetal heart rate is monitored. Fetal heart rate is monitored using electrocardiogram. Okay, electrocardiogram is nothing but the electrical signals generated in the heart which are recorded on the body surface. Okay, you may be knowing what is ECG. Everyone knows it. What is electrocardiogram? To know the function of the heart, generally the cardiologist suggests to take a ECG, electrocardiogram. Most of you are aware. Okay. Yeah. Now we'll see what is noise cancellation model. This is same as our similar to our neural network. This is a filter. You studied FIR filters, right? FIR filters or tapped delay line filters. Okay, I will give you example. Simple filter is, we can have a simple filter which can be your this thing, moving average filter. I'm audible, right? Yeah, we can have a simple moving average filter which could be my y of n is a bracket is equal to x of n minus x of n minus 1. So here I have, what are my filter coefficient in this filter? Anybody? Is it a FIR filter or a IIR filter? Y of n is equal to x of n minus 1. Okay, so what kind of filter it is? Is it a FIR filter or IIR filter? I want from you. It is a FIR filter. Agree? It is a FIR filter.
Yes.
If you derive its filter coefficients, B will be 1, minus 1, and A will be 1. Correct? your B, numerator coefficients are 1 and minus 1, and denominator coefficient is 1 always here. And hence it is a FIR filter. So how do you derive? So y of this, if s of k, if I consider it as y, so x of n is nothing but first this is x of n is multiplied with a coefficient of 1, and it is given to the summer as it is, and you will have a weight of 1 and a delay of 1 unit, and supply x of n with a delay of 1 and multiply the weight with minus 1 and add, and that gives you the moving average system, moving average filter. Okay, same way when we have a lot of filter coefficients, how you do filtering? You will have filter coefficients and you will have the input signal. You have to take convolution x of x and the filter coefficient x and h. You need to take the convolution, and that is your output convolution between x and h. X and h, yes. Now same, when you have the filter coefficients, yes, you need to take the inner product. One way is simple, you can write in a polynomial manner and compute the convolution. Another approach is you can express your convolution as the inner product between your input with the filter coefficients. Instead of recursively computing for every element, you can have a matrix multiplication between your input data x and your filter coefficient h. So xh transpose is your y. Okay, y is nothing but xh transpose. Okay, x is a matrix of input, h is the matrix of filter coefficients. When you take the inner product, you will get the output. This is matrix notation, not the scalar notation which you usually study. Okay, so the input is multiplied, x of n is multiplied with w1 and taken as it is, then input is delayed by 1 unit and that is multiplied by the weight and added, and the input is once again 2 delays are given, then multiplied with the weight w3 and added, and so on up to n times n plus x of k minus n plus 1. Okay, it is repeated for n times this process, and this kind of filter is called tapped delay line filter. If my in your convolution and linear filtering you saw the filter coefficient w1, w2, w3, they are constant throughout. Okay, now in adaptive filters what happens is you based on your x of k, you compute s of k based on the present weights, then you compare that your s of k with d of k, which is the desired output, and if there is any deviation, and that will be your error is equal to dk minus sk, which you can see here. Dk is positively added here and sk is negatively added, together you will get e is equal to dk minus sk, and that is the error. And if this error is large, you have to update these weights such that in the next iteration your error is lesser than the present error, and that process is continued. Okay, so based on your present output s of k, you compare it with the desired weights, desired output, and you compute the error, and if error is large you update the weights, if error is small you ignore. Okay, you continue this process of updating the weight vectors until this error is zero. This error is zero, until then you have to continue the iterative process. Okay, so this is our adaptive noise cancellation. Okay, where filter model only, but adaptive filter you are using. Okay, so in normal course you are seeing filters x multiplied by h, x and h are taken, inner product of x and h is taken, whereas here also we take x and w. Instead of h I have w here, w are weights, x multiplied by w, and I will get the output s of k, and I'll compare this output with the desired output, and then I'll derive a error, and based on the error I'll update my weights. Okay, this is my adaptive filter, where weight or the filter coefficients are repeatedly adapted or updated continuously. Okay, this is your adaptive filter where noise you are cancelling. I will explain further. Okay, this is a adaptive filter where weights you are continuously updating based on the error which is derived from sk and dk. Okay, okay. Now let us say this is a adaptive filter noise cancellation model. Any signal generated in the natural course will be interfered with some noise. Correct? No. whatever signal you take, you are listening me now, you are listening some background sound, maybe fan or maybe vehicles going outside, all those things you listen. Okay, so whenever you acquire a signal in the natural course, what happens is noise is added to it inevitably. Even if you don't want also, you don't have an option. Definitely noise will be added. So signal source is yes, and you refer here, the signal source is yes, okay, and the noise source with which you will get a noise of M naught. So this is the effective or primary input, which is signal plus noise. Okay, now you sample. Okay, the noise is also fed to an adaptive filter. Okay, the noise is not constant. It has some statistical parameters, constant statistical parameters for a noise, but every instance added noise will be different. For example, I'm talking here and you're listening some background sound, vehicles are going out or fan is rotating. So in the next instance, you will not listen the same sound. So noise is like that. So every instance, it will be a different noise. It is not exactly equal, but its statistical properties are constant. Okay, so N naught as well as N1, the statistical properties are constant. It has a given parameters like mean, standard deviation, kurtosis, all those things are fixed, but there are variations. Okay, so N naught is different than N1. Both have the same statistical parameters, but there is a variation. Every time you will not get the same value. You have seen deterministic signal, you have also seen random signals, right? So deterministic signal means you take the signal any number of times, it will be constant. Like you saw your sinusoid. Now you generate a sinusoid, you will get same thing. You generate once again, you will get same signal continuously. Whereas noise is not like that. Noise is statistical in nature. So every instance when you generate a noise, it will have different values, but collective statistical properties are same. Okay, and such signals are called random signals. And what signals you are studying in your signals, DSP and all, they are the deterministic signal, which can be expressed in terms of a mathematical equation. Okay, so now we are having a primary input, which is signal plus noise. Okay, so our aim is to obtain yes. Okay, we have to remove this N naught from the signal source. Our acquired signal consists of some noise called N naught, and this noise we have to remove. So how we'll do is, we'll take a reference input. What we want to remove, an instance of that we'll take, and that is N1. Okay, a reference input is N1. My primary input is S plus N naught. Taking this N1, which has the similar properties of N naught, statistical properties, with which I will cancel my N naught. Okay, S plus N naught I have. I'll subtract N1 from this, and I'll iterate it continuously. And when N1 is equal to N naught, this S plus N naught minus N1. When N1 is N naught, I will get yes. Noise is subtracted. Okay, so my aim is to remove this N naught, and I'll retain only S. That is done by predicting that noise, making it N naught.
Thank you, sir.
Sir, your voice is not audible.
Hello, hello, hello.
Unmute that mic, sir.
Am I audible now?
Yes, sir.
Okay, I was not audible in between sometime.
Yes, sir.
Oh, how long?
The before slide, the last slide.
Oh, slide, previous slide, I was not audible, right?
Yes,
sir. Okay. We'll go to that previous slide and from there we'll continue.
Okay, sir.
One sec. This slide you know, right? Could you understand about this slide? Was I audible?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
So you need explanation for this slide?
Yes,
or can
sir.
I move further? Yeah, I will explain. Yeah, your signal source, any measurement. Huh? This you are clear, right? You want this slide to be explained? You want this slide to be explained?
No, sir.
Okay. Fine. Adaptive noise cancellation we were seeing. There is a primary input, reference input. Primary input is S plus N0 and reference input is N1. Now, error, that is output error, is computed as S plus N0 minus Y. So that is given by epsilon is equal to S plus N0 minus Y. So on squaring on both sides, if I consider S as A and N0 minus Y as B, and square it, so epsilon square will be S square plus N0 minus Y whole square plus 2 into S into N0 minus Y. This is the expression we will get. Now, taking average on both sides, that is the expectation operator, we will get expected value of error square is equal to expected value of the signal square plus expected value of N0 minus Y square plus 2E into a signal into difference of noise. Okay. Now we can see it. The last expression which we saw was this. This is the expression which we saw, e expected value of error square. So we can see the last term, since the signal multiplied by the noise. Since signal generates from a different source, noise is generating from a different source, they are not correlated. Okay, they don't have anything in common. Example, I'm giving this lecture here, and outside vehicles are moving. They are not related to what I'm speaking. I don't know what vehicles are going outside. And also the vehicles, they don't know what I'm speaking. So these two signals are totally uncorrelated. When you take the inner product or average of these two, S into this thing, you will get a zero. Okay, the expected value of two functions, when the two functions are not correlated, you will get the resultant is zero. So therefore you will get expected value of epsilon square is equal to first two terms only, third term will be zero. Okay, now you have to find out the minimum of squared error. Okay, mean squared error you have, no? So mean you are computed by taking the expectation. You have a square value of the function, this is the squared value, then you are taking the average. Okay, average of squared value and its minimum, that will be your least mean squared error, which is computed as minimum of this expected value of epsilon square, which will be equal to minimum of S square plus expected value of n naught minus pi whole square. Now the first term E of S square, that cannot be minimized because it is a signal square, whereas the other one, difference between two noise values, of course that can be minimized. So that is the objective now. So whatever error you minimize, it is minimizing the two errors, n naught and minimizing the difference between the two errors, n naught and y. However, it is same as making y equal to n naught. Okay, you are making y equal to n naught. As a result, the minimum of the difference of these two will be zero. So the error will be, minimum error is square of the signal. Okay, that is the inference about adaptive noise cancellation. Okay, any doubts in this? Anything you have not understood? Understood, right? Okay, we'll move to the next concept. I will briefly complete it in 5 minutes because I had to close this session in 8 minutes. It gives only 40 minutes. Half an hour or 40 minutes it gives. Okay, so you have now we are monitoring of the fetal heart rate. We are monitoring fetal heart rate where mother and fetus ECGs are overlapping. What is ECG? ECG is nothing but the signal generated in the heart of any human being. Okay, when a woman is pregnant, since her heart beats, there is a ECG signal generating, as well as in the fetus, because of the womb, there is a heartbeat of that. Okay, there is a heartbeat because of it is a fetus. Okay, so the two signals, when you measure the ECG signal on the chest, it gives you the signal. The A gives the ECG signal measured on the chest of the mother, okay, which has some power line, 60 hertz power line interference. That is these things, no? You can see the oscillations right here. I just marked it. Okay, you are finding the oscillations, right? I'm not getting a response from you. Hello?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
So this is 60 hertz noise, mother and fetus. This is measured on the chest. Yeah, signal A is measured on the chest, whereas signal B, it is measured on the abdomen of the mother, okay, which contains both mother ECG, to which fetus ECG is also added. And fetus ECG has a higher heart rate and mother ECG has a lower heart rate. As a result, you can find this is a fetus ECG. Once again, another cycle like this, okay. Whereas mother ECG, it is not that frequent. Okay, just a minute, I'm getting back to you. Yeah, hello, I'm audible right now?
Yes,
okay, so you can see that here the 60 hertz power line interference is there, which is overriding on the ECG signal, correct? This also is the same thing. Okay, it should have been a smooth function. Instead, there are variation, small peaks, and they are due to the 60 hertz power line interference. Okay, this is the ECG recorded on the abdomen, sorry, on the chest, A, and B is the ECG measured on the abdomen, in which mother and fetus ECGs are added up. Okay, and we can see the third picture where we can see that using adaptive filtering, we are cancelling the power line interference. Okay, so the first one is a reference signal, that is N1. First A1, A is nothing but N1. And the second B is S plus N1, and this is first one is S plus N naught. Okay, the signal which you are seeing in A is N naught, and the second signal is S plus N1, and third signal is your adaptive signal due to adaptive noise cancellation, which is S again, S plus N1 minus N naught. Okay. This is how you can remove the 60 hertz interference, power line interference. Okay, any doubts? Can I move to the next?
Yes,
okay.
Sir.
Okay. Yeah. Now here you can see in the recording of the fetal ECG experiment over a bandwidth, this is the ECG measured in the chest A. B is nothing but the ECG of mother and fetus. This is the mother ECG and this is the fetus ECG. These things here also, there is one overlapping, this one, etc. These are fetus ECG, they are added up, and from that this you consider as N naught, and this you consider as N1 plus S plus N1, and this is, as a result you will get S. Okay, S is equal to S plus N1 minus N0. Okay, this is your processed ECG. Okay, processed ECG, which is free from power line interference. Okay, any doubts you have, we can interact. Any doubts? Okay, today what we talked, we discussed about applications of LMS algorithm, where we saw how noise filtering can be done, noise cancellation can be done, and other application what we saw was how to cancel 60 hertz power line interference from the ECG, abdominal ECG of fetus and mother together. Okay, out of which how to remove 60 hertz power line interference. Okay, any doubts? Okay, tomorrow we'll take class on same module. We will discuss about multi-layered neural network architecture. Okay, multi-layered neural network architecture, where we will see a neural network which consists of many layers, and in each layer a number of neurons are present. Okay, and how to update the weights in each layer, each neuron. We will see some algorithm there, and that is called backpropagation learning algorithm. Backpropagation means you have a given input fed to the first layer of the neural network. It passes, computes, and go to the last layer, compare it with the desired output, and then compute the error, and based on the error update the immediate previous layer weight, and based on that compute error is back propagated and update weights are updated. Okay, this algorithm we'll study in the next class. A multi-layer neural network and back propagation learning algorithm we'll study in the next class. Okay, anything you want to tell? Quality of the class, like audio, video, slides? Hello, you want to say anything about the quality of the class, like audio, video, whether slides are visible? Whether slides?
Yes, sir.
Okay, okay. You are following the class?
Yes, sir.
Okay, okay, okay. Okay, then we'll see in the next class. Okay. Tomorrow we'll study about error back propagation neural network architecture and algorithm. Both we'll study in the next class. Okay. See you in the next class. Okay.
Okay, sir.
Okay.
Okay, sir.
You be at home and don't go outside, and take care about your good health. Okay. Yes, see you.
Good day.